All right, let's go to Isaiah chapter number 41. Isaiah 41. This is one of those chapters, you could just start in verse 1 and just preach. And preach. A precious, wonderful chapter. The basic tenor of the chapter is God challenging the true God, Lord God Jehovah, the God of Israel, challenging Israel's current false gods. You could almost see a courtroom scene. And the one New Testament verse that clearly comes out as you read this chapter is Romans 11:36. For of him and through him and to him are all things, to whom be glory forever and ever. Amen. One of the big doctrinal things that comes out here is the sovereignty of God in his ruling of this world. God raises nations, God puts them down. God blesses nations, God judges nations. God puts the leaders in that he wants, God takes the leaders out when it is their time. Everything on this world, from the wind to the roaring of the sea to the leaders that govern under the nation that exists, God is in charge of it all. Amen. Now, I think that's really important for the Christian community today. Because you don't get that when you watch the news. What a bedlam of mishmash. I don't think that's in the dictionary yet. But when you go to the Bible, it all makes sense. Now, there's one thing that I have picked out after I've walked you through the chapter. There are five things in this chapter, and I want to walk you through them. It's only 29 verses. It will not take that long. But then, there are 12 times that God says, I will do this for you. And each one of those 12, I will do this for you, is something different that God does in the Christian life. So of the varied and many ways that I could have taken this chapter, what I really want to do tonight is just encourage you how well God is acquainted with all of our lives and how God leads and guides us and protects us. That's the one thought I want to get out of this toward the end. But first of all, I want us to look at the greatness of God versus the uselessness of idols and the weakness of man, quite frankly, to control anything. It's one of the side effects of the sin nature. We think we are so in control. We're not in control of anything. God. So, first of all, in verse 1 through 4 is the prophecy of God handpicking a king by the name of Cyrus, who God would use to liberate the children of Israel from their 70-year Babylonian captivity. There are a few things, not all, but there are a few things about Cyrus that are also emblematic of the Lord Jesus Christ, the great King of Kings, who in the yet to come future time will again liberate the Jewish people out of the great tribulation. And though the nation has been at that point greatly diminished in number, yet what does it matter? God and one are a majority anyway. So, the first four verses is about Cyrus. Keep silence before me, O islands. Islands is an Old Testament metaphoric word for all peoples and all nations. Islands. It took me a long time to learn that. people renew their strength. He's talking about Israel, who had been reduced to poverty and misery and captivity because of their worship of idols. And now he's announcing to them a temporary respite from that. Let them come near, let them speak. By the way, first listen, then speak. Boy, don't we all need to be reminded of that. Let us come near together to judgment. In other words, the courtroom scene is set. Here's the great God. Here's the sinning people and their idolatry. God, who raised up the righteous man from the east, called him to his foot, gave the nations before him, and made him rule over kings. Now the word kings and kingdoms in the Bible is used interchangeably. Sometimes the man, sometimes his kingdom, many times both. Kings, and made him ruler of kings, and gave them as dust to his sword and as driven stubble to his bow. That would be Cyrus. He pursued them, passed safely even by the way that he had not gone with his feet. Who hath wrought and done it? Calling the generations from the beginning, I the Lord, the first, and with the last, I am here. The first people, Adam and Eve, every succeeding generation, God orders them. And the circumstances of their existence, whether that be liberty or bondage, whether that be riches or poverty, whether that be a great nation or a little island nation, God orders all. I am the first, and with me the last. I am he. Now he's not talking about Cyrus. He's talking about himself. So you have the announcement that Cyrus, the Persian king, will liberate, conquest, whoop Babylon, destroy it, and all the nations of the Middle East around him, and will rule a great kingdom. And God will use him to free Israelites from the Babylonian captivity. Now, the effect of such a decree by God given to Cyrus, the effect of that, verse 5 through 7, the isle saw it and feared, the ends of the earth were afraid, drew near and came, they helped everyone his neighbor, and everyone said to his brother, be of good courage. So the carpenter encouraged the goldsmith, and he that smoothed with the hammer, him that smote the anvil, saying, it is ready for the soldering, and he fastened it with nails that it should not be moved. That was God's charge against Israel. That was God's charge against the nations of that day. So the response of the nations, instead of repentance, they made more idols. Instead of bowing to God, they increased their bowing to the nation, to their idols. Just like in the end time, this in measure is a prophecy of what is yet to come. In the great tribulation, in times of great judgment under not Cyrus, but the future King of Kings and Lord of Lords, instead of under that terrible 7-year tribulation period, bowing to God, they bow to a false God that you and I know is Antichrist. By the way, the direction that our beloved nation is now going, no human can stop that, only God can stop that. We should pray for revival, yes. But folks, our nation in every conceivable way is past the help of man. Our to be negative. I like being negative. I like being a good old boy. But sometimes the truth is the truth. Yeah. Only God can turn us now.
Right.
Yeah. Do I, will he? I don't know. And you don't either. But thou, okay, now then, verse 8 through 20, God now addresses his own nation, his own people. Out of this section, after a while, I will draw a nice, a conclusion to encourage your heart. But thou, Israel, art my servant, Jacob, whom I have chosen, the seed of Abraham, my friend. Now he's going to address his own nation. God picked him for himself, not because they were strong, because they weren't, or big, because they weren't, or rich, because they weren't, or educated, because they weren't. They were just a small band of farmers who couldn't even put an army together. God likes doing that. God likes passing over sometimes to think the person that we think is most qualified to the most unlikely person. Why does God like doing that? So he'll get the glory. Why God does it. Thou, Israel, whom I have chosen, have taken from the ends of the earth and called thee from the chief men thereof, or apart from the chief men thereof, and said unto thee, thou art my servant, I have chosen thee, and not cast thee away. Now it's amazing when you study the history of Israel, their ingratitude, their pride. Their violation of everything that God ever told them to do or be, and turned up gods of gold and silver and stone, and still at this point, God hath not cast them away. By the way, God still hadn't cast them away. They're in captivity, but God really never has cast them away.
Amen.
Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee, I will help thee, I will uphold thee with the right hand of righteousness. In other words, God, here's what God's saying. You're fixing to go through some terrible, terrible times, which, by the way, have not lasted almost 2,600 years, but they're still God's people. You know, if you and I mess up bad, God may whoop us. He may bring us off the low, but we're still his child.
Amen.
We're still his child. Amen. Behold, all they that were incensed against thee, and that pretty much is the whole world, shall be ashamed and confounded. They shall be as nothing, and they that strive with thee shall perish. Israel many times has, and in the future will still come out victorious, because who? The great God is fighting for them. They are his people. God always defends his children.
Amen. Yeah.
And you can take that to the bank, as your saint goes.
Yeah.
Thou shalt seek them, talking about Israel's enemy, and shall not find them, even them that contend with thee. They that war against thee shall be as nothing, as a thing of naught. For I, the Lord thy God, will hold thy right hand, saying unto thee, fear not, I will help thee. Fear not, thou worm Jacob, and ye men of Israel, I will help thee, saith the Lord, and thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Behold, I will make thee a new sharp threshing instrument having teeth. Thou shalt thresh the mountains like kings, represent nations, mighty nations, and beat them small, and shall make them the hills as chaff. Thou shalt fan them, and the wind shall carry them away, and the whirlwind shall scatter them. And thou shalt rejoice in the Lord, and shall glory in the Holy One of Israel. All these physical illustrations, wind, sand, storm, threshing, dust, those are all emblematic words of what God will do with Israel's enemies. When the poor and needy seek water and there is none, and their tongue faileth for thirst, I, the Lord, will hear them. I, the God of Israel, will not forsake them. I will open rivers in high places and fountains in the midst of the valley. I make the wilderness a pool of water and dry land springs of water. I will plant the wilderness, the cedar, the cedar tree, the myrtle, the oil tree. I will set in the desert the fir tree and the pine and the box tree together, that they may see and know and consider and understand together that the hand of the Lord hath done this, and the Holy One of Israel hath created it. The grass, the flowers, the trees, the blooming desert, which the desert will again bloom and be a garden. Those are all symbolic words for how the Lord will deliver Israel out of their worst situations. And Israel will yet rule by God, the Lord Jesus Christ, in Jerusalem and in Judea. And all those nations will yet submit. It looks like a terrible mess now. And by the way, no government, including ours, no leader, including ours, will ever make peace over there till Jesus comes. You know why? Because if they did, God would be a liar. God said to that illegitimate son Abraham had by the Egyptian maid, he shall have war with other nations from generation to generation. He said he will be a wild man. And every time you see, you turn on your TV and you watch the news of what's going on over there, you see that scenario played out. But that will come to an end. They're God's people, and while God severely chastens them, he will not ultimately forsake them. So, Cyrus, the effect on the nation, is addressed to Israel. Now, his contentious challenge and contempt and rebuke of their idolatry, that's in two divisions with an interruption. First of all, verse 21 to 24. Produce your cause, says the Lord. Bring forth your strong reasons, says the king of Jacob. He's talking to the idols and to the makers of the idols. Let them bring forth. Show us what shall happen. Let them show the former things, what they be, that we may consider them and know the latter end of them, or clear things for to come. Show the things that are to come hereafter, that we may know them, that ye are gods, small g. Ye, do good, do evil, that we may be dismayed, and behold it altogether. God saying to the idols and their makers, you're so smart, what part of history did you make? You're so intelligent, tell us the future, like I tell the future. It is a contemptuous rebuke of idolatry and idolaters. Behold, ye are as nothing, and your work of naught. An abomination is he that chooseth you. Anything other than trust and faith and reliance on the Lord God of the Bible, as Solomon learned, must and will come to vanity. And then again, verse 28 and verse 29. For I beheld, and there was no man even among them, and there was no counselor that, when I asked them, could answer me a word. In other words, there was not one of them. Multitudes of idols had one word to offer when God spoke. Behold, they are all vanity, and their works are nothing. Their molten images are wind and confusion. Isn't that amazing how such a nation called by God, so blessed? What did he do for me? Fed them with food out of heaven, the water come rushing out of rocks. He led them by a cloud in the daytime and by rain at night. He subdued all their enemies. He gave them a whole nation, I mean a whole country. The houses were built, the trees were blooming, the orchards were prospering, the land was fertile. It was a beautiful country full of minerals. And they said, no thanks, my turn to idols. So there's one more thing, and that is verse 25 to 27. Now the Lord God is talking beyond Cyrus and the Babylonian captivity. He's talking about his own son, the Lord Jesus Christ, the King of kings and Lord of lords. In other words, the Old Testament is always a near fulfillment and a far fulfillment. It's usually threefold. Number one, to the people that he was talking to, the Jewish state then. Number two, to the future state yet to come, which is what he's fixing to do. And number three, practical to us. Okay? Always, Old Testament. Verse 25. I've set up one from the north, and he shall come. From the rising of the sun shall he be called upon my name. Shall he call upon my name? And he shall come upon princes as upon mortal, and as the potter treadeth the clay. Who hath declared from the beginning that we may know, and before time that we may say, is he righteous? Yea, there is none that showeth, yea, there is none that declareth, yea, there is none that heareth your words. They shall say to Zion, behold them, I will give Jerusalem one that bringeth good tidings. So there's a prophecy of the coming Lord Jesus Christ. Amen. There is the prophecy that the Lord God Almighty, the Lord Jesus Christ, will come, will rule, will reign. Now, I said, in this chapter, which can be approached from many, many angles, let me give you one thing for practical application to your life and to my life. And I don't have, each one of these could be a sermon, but I'm just going to mention them. Verse 10, I will strengthen thee. There is strength in weakness for you and for me. Also in verse 10, I will help thee. There is equipment for conflict. Number 3, verse 10, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness. There's God holding our hand as we walk through this world. Verse 13, I, the Lord, will hold thy right hand, saying, fear not. There is the assurance of a friend that sticketh closer than a brother. Verse 13, I will help thee. There is the help of sustainment in trial. Verse 13, fear not. There is preservation when fearful. Verse 15, I will make thee a new sharp threshing instrument having teeth. There is strength in service and strength for the battle. Verse 17, the Lord will hear them. There is your encouragement when you pray. Verse 18, I will open rivers in high places and fountains in the midst of the valleys. There is your promise of supply in the hour of need, physically as well as spiritually. Verse 18, I will make the wilderness a pool of water and dry land springs of water. There is assistance as your life is slowly but surely conformed to the image of Christ. By the way, God planted you, and Christian life is not an overnight thing. You plant a tree, it takes years to grow that tree, and God uses your whole lifetime to make you into the beautiful thing that he has in mind for you. Then verse 19, I will set in the desert trees. There is the bestowment of usefulness in life. We in this country of Texas, in semi-arid country, how wonderful is a tree? How much it aids us to get out of the roaring sun and sit under a cool tree and drink a glass of water or a glass of tea. Folks, it doesn't matter who you are or what your needs are. God knows them. God is aware of them. yourselves and stay close to God. He will meet those every need. Even in a small church like this, we have people who are sick. We have people who have family problems. We have people who have relationship problems. We have people who have problems with children. We have people who need a job. We have people with problems on the job. We have children who are struggling in school, and the list goes on and on. God knows that. And God will lead in that. I will help thee. Someone wrote this, and I'm going to read it to you. Here's the spring where waters flow to quench a heart of sin. Here's the tree where the truth doth grow to lead our hearts therein. Here's the judge that stints the strife when men's devices fail. Here's the bread that feeds the life that death cannot assail. Amen?
Yeah.
How about this? The tidings of salvation, dear, come to our hearts from hence. The fortress of our faith is here and shield of our defense. Then be not like a hull that hath a pearl at his desire, but takes more pleasure in the trough and wallowing in the mire. Read not the book in any case, but with a single eye. Read not, but first desire God's grace to understand thereby. Pray still in faith with this respect to fructify therein, that knowledge may bring this effect to mortify thy sin. Then happy thou in all thy life, whatso to thee befalls. Yea, doubly happy shalt thou be when God by death thee calls. There's another New Testament application of this whole chapter, Philippians 4:13. I can do all things through Christ, which strengtheneth me. Folks, the grace that saved us is the grace that keeps us. The grace that forgives us is the grace that helps us in our walk. What Paul said to the Corinthian church, because they were so proud of their talents and their possessions and everything else, God said to them, what hast thou that thou didst not receive? And the answer is nothing. Nothing. Let's stay close to the Lord. Amen. He'll take care of us. Amen?
Amen.
Okay, perfect timing. 30 minutes. I'm a 30-minute guy. Mostly. Thank you for being here tonight. I hope this hour has been an encouragement, been a help, been a blessing. Thank you for what you do for each other. It really makes me proud.